And I'm going to read from Psalms 89, verses 1 through 8. I will sing of the Lord's great love forever. With my mouth, I'll make your faithfulness known through all generations. I will declare that your love stands firm forever, that you have established your faithfulness in heaven itself. You said, I have made a covenant with my chosen one. I have sworn to David, my servant. I will establish your line forever and make your throne firm through all generations. The heavens praise your wonders, Lord, your faithfulness too in the assembly of the holy ones. For who in the skies above can compare with the Lord? Who is like the Lord among the heavenly beings? In the council of the holy ones, God is greatly feared. He is more awesome than all who surround him. Who is like you, Lord God Almighty? You, Lord, are mighty, and your faithfulness surrounds you. Please stand as we begin to sing about our Lord.
Seated on the throne of mercy, your glory shining bright for all to see.
new song for you today. It's one we did at the beginning. It's super easy to pick up. You just sing with us.
Dominion, Lord, please.
morning. It's great to see everybody here this morning. Welcome, welcome, welcome. It's wonderful May already, huh? Hard to believe. It's come to prayer time this morning. Is that wonderful to sing those songs? Who is like the Lord? Do you believe that? Amen. Glorify your name. Name above all names. Do you believe that? Do you believe that we are praying to the King of Kings? Amen. Let's look at our prayer list this morning. You can find it. Do you have any updates or additions? I'd like to say thank you to everyone for the prayers and for all of the gifts that we received at birth of Davis. Appreciate that. We're doing well. So the Lord is good and gracious and kind. It's from Psalm 116, verses 1 and 2. I love the Lord because he has heard my voice and my supplications, because he has inclined his ear to me. Therefore, I will call upon him as long as I live. Let that be our prayer this morning. I'm going to ask Patty just to play a little bit this morning while I give us about 30 seconds to a minute. It's great to practice here in a community of believers. So if you haven't, it's been a while since you've prayed, I encourage you to pray during this time. So go ahead, Patty. Almighty God, King of Kings, Lord of Lords, thank you for hearing our prayers. Let us call upon you as long as we live. Lift up Gary and Bud and Mike for their active treatments right now, and pray for wisdom for those taking care of them. I pray for support for their loved ones and families, and encouragement, Lord, along this difficult time that they're going through. For Renee and Rose and Gail and others that are still feeling after effects of treatments, Lord, just help them. For Letha, for Alice, help them, Lord, and help us as believers just to keep them in our prayers. For our nursing home residents, Jack and Barb and Carol and Judy and Margaret. For Beth and Angie, recovering from complications of disease and sickness. And pray for the persecuted church around the world. Lord, we just lift up these physical needs to you. We also recognize we have so many spiritual needs. Sins that we've committed in the past, sins that we are committing right now, and sins we will commit in the future. Let us remember that Jesus paid it all on the cross for us. And let us believe that more today. We just say thank you. Thank you for the life that has been brought into this world, for the lives that are still in the womb. We are so grateful for those new additions, Lord, and we thank you for the encouragement that we've seen the past couple weeks with baptisms and decisions being made for you to follow you all of our days. Just pray that you would lift us up in worship this morning to see your glory, and pray for just everyone here in this room as well as those that are away from us. those that we haven't seen in a while. Let us just be bold and be encouraging to those. We just say thank you, Lord, for everything that you've done for us, everything that you will continue to do. In your Son's name we pray. Amen.
Meditation this morning, I would like us to see how our roads and paths that we choose to take on this earth is like the roads and path that Jesus took on earth when he was here. There are similarities and there are many differences. The first one we all know, Jesus was born of the flesh, just like you and I. He was a human being, just like us. And you know, it must have been a tough assignment to go from being the Son of God to being a human guy like us. He experienced the same emotions, desires, and passions as we do. Love to hate, joy and sorrow, grief and happiness, peace and turmoil. anger into calmness, and very, very many more. Very similar to what we experience here on earth as well. Except for one difference. He lived his life without sin. We cannot say that. In Romans 5, 6 through 8 is his promise. You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous man. Though for a good man, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Jesus never lost sight of his purpose on earth. Even when he had to endure beatings, a crown of thorns, being spit upon, and then being nailed to a cross, his purpose was still to please his Father. We sometimes lose our sight on our purpose on earth. We are overcome by what society has in mind for us and are easily tempted by worldly views, then find ourselves wanting to please others as well as ourselves. Jesus' life was focused on showing others that there is life after death for us all. Even when we sin, he will show us his mercy if we will repent and ask for forgiveness from deep within our own heart. As Christians, we try to live a life of Jesus in what we do for others, as well as for our fellow Christians, such as praying, encouragement, helping those in need, giving unconditional love. Psalms 48 reads, I desire to do your will, O God. Your law is within my heart. Jesus has taught us that we should do unto others what we would want done unto us. This morning, our path to heaven is focused on the teachings of Jesus that are represented on our communion table here today. Hebrews 11:1. Now faith is confidence in what we hope for, and assurance about what we do not see. His life he freely sacrificed out of love for each one of us, so we may have life after our death. Will you please pray with me? We say thank you, Lord, for the sacrifice of your one and only Son, for the mental and physical abuse upon your body, and your scars that was revealed for all to see. We again say thank you. May these emblems of your broken body and shed blood on our table be etched in our hearts and minds throughout our time on earth, each and every day. We ask all of these things in your Son's Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, we have the Bible quiz slide up here. I'll point out that the Northside had more responses last week. Way to go, guys. But the week before, I forgot to point out, we had the Northside had a 100% correct response rate. So way to go, guys. That was the first of the year. We have been doing a quiz for our Bible reading that we've been going through this year, where we're reading through the New Testament and Psalms together. And so that's always on the inside of your bulletin. If you want to fill that out, you can drop it in a box in the foyer. Eventually, the scoring format is going to change here, because all that we care about is the number of correct answers your side gets. And so I'll change the way this graphic looks when I get time to do that. But if you fill out a quiz and get just one question right for your side, then you will have helped. All right? So if you are maybe intimidated or thinking, I don't know many of these questions, if you know one, fill it out, drop it in. For your side of the church, it's a fun little competition we're doing. You guys have done such a great job filling out the quiz and doing a reading with us. I wanted to do a little reading with you this morning. And the passage we're going to be looking at is 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 1 through 6. And we are going to read those verses. But that's not the only thing we're going to read this morning. It will be a little different. I'd like you to show me some grace, because there's a story that I am fond of that just portrays the information that we get in these verses in 2 Corinthians 4, I think, very well. And so it may feel today like you're at story time at the library instead of at church. And that, I don't know how you'll feel about that, but we'll do it together. I'm going to be reading from a book called The Silver Chair by C.S. Lewis. It's in the Narnia series. I think it's book number 6. And so I need to set that up for you. In The Silver Chair, it begins with a boy named Eustace. He's also known as Scrub. And then also a girl named Jill. And they happen upon a door at their school, which takes them from the normal world that we live in into Narnia. This is how all the Narnia books start. And so they find themselves in Narnia, and the news in Narnia, when they arrive there, is not good. The aging King Caspian of Narnia has set out to sea. His wife has been attacked and killed by a vile serpent, and his son, Prince Rillian, set after pursuing this murderous serpent, but disappeared in the woods. And that was 10 years before. The kingdom of Narnia is in a desperate state. Aslan, he's a lion present in all the Narnia books, and he's a sort of God or Christ figure in the books. Aslan tasks Jill and Scrub with going to find Prince Rillian so that he can be returned to the throne of Narnia. So that's their quest. Jill and Scrub are going to go find Prince Rillian, and they're going to bring him back so that he can be the king of Narnia and they can have some sort of revival there. Aslan reveals to them 4 signs to follow on their journey. The final sign is that someone will speak the name of Aslan, and that is when they will have completed their task. The two of them are joined on this journey by a duckman-like creature called a marshwiggle. So we see the 3 of them there. The marshwiggle's name is Puddleglum. He's the big guy on the left. They track through the land of giants north of Narnia in search of Prince Rillian through much peril before they find a sign that directs them underground, where they surprisingly find a vast underground kingdom full of creatures called Earthmen, who are a curious assortment of brutish, gnome-like figures with swords and spears. The Earthmen imprison the 3 travelers and take them across their vast underground kingdom to the city of their queen, wishing to present them to her as their captives. And while my summary has gone quickly, at this point we're nearly 4/5 of the way through the book. Just as they are to be committed to a jail cell there, a human voice calls out from a distant chamber and demands that the 3 travelers be brought into his presence. There in the castle of the queen of the underland, they find one of her knights, a human, not an earthman, clad in black. They're in this underland where there is no sky. They're permanently underground. The knight that they find is a boastful man who tells Jill and Scrub and Puddleglum of he and the queen's plan, which is nearly complete, to tunnel to the overland, that is the above ground world, and conquer kingdoms with earthmen so that they may rule over them by force. The knight has many kind and glowing words to speak about the queen of the underworld who is away on a trip. In fact, the queen has been so kind to the knight that the queen is helping that this knight that they encounter survive a wicked enchantment that he is suffering. The knight tells the three travelers, Scrub, Jill, and Puddleglum, that every night for a brief moment he goes insane. And if he were not restrained, he would turn into a terrible, murderous serpent. But the queen is so kind that she ensures every evening that the knight is bound into an enchanted silver chair and restrained to it during his madness so that he will not be afflicted. As the knight speaks with the three travelers, he realizes that the hour of his enchantment is growing near. So he directs the three travelers to an adjacent room while his earthmen guards come in and bind him to the enchanted silver chair. So I'm going to pick up reading as Jill and Scrub, whose real name is Eustace, and Puddleglum re-enter the room where the queen's knight has now been bound to his silver chair before his fit of madness begins. I'm going to pull my own chair over here. And we'll pick up with the book. They went back down the corridor and gently pushed the door open. "It's all right," said Scrub, meaning that there were no earthmen about. Then they all came back into the room where they had supped. The main door was now shut, concealing the curtain behind which they had first entered. The knight was seated in a curious silver chair to which he was bound by his ankles, his knees, his elbows, his wrists, and his waist. There was sweat on his forehead, and his face was filled with anguish. "Come in, friends," he said, glancing quickly up. "The fit is not yet upon me. Make no noise, for I am told that prying chamberlain that you were in bed. Now I can feel it coming. Quick, listen while I am master of myself. While the fit is upon me, it well may be that I shall beg and implore you with entreaties and threatenings to loosen my bonds. They say I do. I shall call upon you by all that is most dear and most dreadful, but do not listen to me. Harden your hearts and stop your ears, for while I am bound, you are safe. But if once I were up and out of this chair, then first would come my fury, and after that, he shuddered, the change into a loathsome serpent. "Oh, there's no fear of losing you," said Puddleglum. "We've no wish to meet wild men or serpents either." "I should think not," said Scrub and Jill together. "All the same," added Puddleglum in a whisper, "don't let's be too sure. Let's be on our guard. We've muffed everything else, you know. He'll be cunning. I shouldn't wonder, once he gets started. Can we trust one another? Do we all promise that whatever he says, we don't touch those cords? Whatever he says, mind you." "Rather," said Scrub. "There's nothing in the world he can say or do that'll make me change my mind," said Jill. "Hush, something's happening," said Puddleglum. The knight was moaning. His face was as pale as putty, and he writhed in his bonds. And whether because she was sorry for him or for some other reason, Jill thought that he looked like a nicer sort of man than he had looked before. "Ah," he groaned. "Enchantments, enchantments, the heavy, tangled, cold, clammy web of evil magic, buried alive, dragged down under the earth, down into the sooty blackness. How many years is it? Have I lived 10 years or 1,000 years in the pit? Maggot men all around me. Oh, have mercy. Let me out. Let me go back. Let me feel the wind and see the sky. There used to be a little pool. When you looked down into it, you could see all the trees growing upside down in the water, all the green, and below them, deep, very deep, the blue sky." He had been speaking in a low voice. Now he looked up, fixed his eyes upon them, and said loud and clear, "Quick! I am sane now. Every night I am sane. If only I could get out of this enchanted chair, it would last. I should be a man again, but every night they bind me, and so every night my chance is gone. But you are not enemies. I am not your prisoner. Quick, cut these cords." "Stand fast, steady," said Puddleglum to the two children. "I beseech you to hear me," said the knight, forcing himself to speak calmly. "Have they told you that if I am released from this chair, I shall kill you and become a serpent? I see by your faces that they have. It is a lie. It is at this hour that I am in my right mind, and all the rest of the day that I am enchanted. You are not earthmen nor witches. Why should you be on their side? Of your courtesy, cut my bonds." "Steady, steady," said the three travelers to one another. "Oh, you have hearts of stone," said the knight. "Believe me, you look upon a wretch who has suffered almost more than any mortal can bear. What wrong have I ever done to you that you should side with my enemies to keep me in such miseries? And the minutes are slipping past. Now you can save me. When this hour is past, I shall be witless again, and the toy lapdog, nay, more like a pawn and tool of the most devilish sorceress that ever planned the woes of men. And this night of all nights, when she is away, you can take me from a chance that may never come again. This is dreadful. I do wish we'd stayed away till it was over," said Jill. "Steady," said Puddleglum. The prisoner's voice was now rising into a shriek. "Let me go, I say. Give me my sword, my sword. Once I am free, I shall take such revenge on earthmen that Underland will talk of it for 1,000 years. "Now the frenzy is beginning," said Scrub. "I hope those knots are all tight." "Yes," said Puddleglum. He'd have twice his natural strength if he got free now. And I'm not clever with my sword. He'd get us both, I shouldn't wonder. And then Pole on her own would be left to tackle the snake." The prisoner was now straining at his bonds so that they cut into his wrists and ankles. "Beware," he said, "beware. One night I did break them, but the witch was there that time. You will not have her to help you tonight. Free me now, and I am your friend. I'm your mortal enemy else." "Cunning, isn't he?" said Puddleglum. "Once and for all," said the prisoner, "I adjure you to set me free. By all fears and all loves, by the bright skies of Overland, by the great lion, by Aslan himself, I charge you." "Oh," said the three travelers, as though they had been hurt. "It's the sign," said Puddleglum. "It was the words of the sign," said Scrub more cautiously. "What are we to do?" said Jill. It was a dreadful question. What had been the use of promising one another that they would not on any account set the knight free if they were to now do so the first time he happened to call upon a name they really cared about? On the other hand, what had been the use of learning the signs if they weren't going to obey them? Yet could Aslan really have meant them to unbind anyone, even a lunatic who asked it in his name? Could it be a mere accident? Or how, if the queen of the underworld knew about all the signs and had made the knight learn about his name simply in order to entrap them? But then, supposing this was the real sign, they had already messed up the first three. They daren't muff the fourth. "Oh, if only we knew," said Jill. "I think we do know," said Puddleglum. "Do you mean you think everything will come right if we untie him?" said Scrub. "I don't know about that," said Puddleglum. "You see, Aslan didn't tell Pole what would happen. He only told her what to do. That fellow will be the death of us once he's up, I shouldn't wonder, but that doesn't let us off following what Aslan told us to do." They all stood looking at one another with bright eyes. It was a sickening moment. "All right," Jill said suddenly, "let's get it over with. Goodbye, everyone." They all shook hands. The knight was screaming by now. There was foam on his cheeks. "Come on, Scrub," said Puddleglum. He and Scrub drew their swords and went over to the captive. "In the name of Aslan," they said, and began methodically cutting the cords. The instant the prisoner was free, he crossed the room in a single bound, seized his own sword, which had been taken from him, and laid it on the table. And he drew it. "You first," he cried, and he fell upon the silver chair. That must have been a good sword. The silver gave way before its edge like a string, and in a moment, a few twisted fragments shining on the floor were all that were left. But as the chair broke, there came from it a bright flash, a sound like a small thunder, and for one moment, a loathsome smell. "Lie there, vile engine of sorcery," he said, "lest your mistress should use you for another victim." Then he turned and surveyed his rescuers, and the something wrong, whatever it was, had vanished from his face. "What?" he cried, turning to Puddleglum. "Do I see before me a marshwiggle? A real, live, honest Narnian marshwiggle?" "Oh, so you have heard of Narnia, after all," said Jill. "Had I forgotten it when I was under the spell?" asked the knight. "Well, that and all the other bedevilments are now over. You may well believe that I know Narnia, for I am Rillian, Prince of Narnia, and Caspian the Great King is my father." "Your Royal Highness," said Puddleglum, sinking on one knee, and the children did the same. "We have come hither for no other end than to seek you." "And who are you, my other deliverers?" said the prince to Scrub and Jill. "We were sent by Aslan himself from beyond the world's end to seek your highness," said Scrub. "I am Eustace, who sailed with him to the island of Ramandu." I owe all three of you a greater debt than I can ever pay, said Prince Rilian. But my father, is he yet alive? He sailed again east before we left Narnia, my lord, said Puddleglum. But your highness must consider that the king is very old. It is 10 to 1 his majesty must die on the voyage. He is old, you say. How long, then, have I been in the power of the witch? It is more than 10 years since your highness was lost in the woods on the north side of Narnia. 10 years? Said the prince, drawing his hand across his face as if to rub away the past. Yes, I believe you, for now that I am myself, I can remember that enchanted life. Though while I was enchanted, I could not remember my true self. And now, fair friends, but wait. I hear their feet. Oh, does it not sicken a man, that padding, woolly tread? I hear their feet on the stairs. Lock, by the door, boy, or stay. I have a better thought than that. I will fool these earthmen, if Aslan gives me the wit. Take your cue from me. He walked resolutely to the door and flung it wide open. Two earthmen entered, but instead of advancing into the room, they placed themselves one on each side of the door and bowed deeply. They were followed immediately by the last person whom anyone had expected or wished to see, the Lady of the Green Kirtle, the Queen of the Underland. She stood dead still in the doorway, and they could see her eyes moving as she took in the whole situation, the three strangers, the silver chair destroyed, and the prince free with his sword in his hand. She turned very white. But Jill thought it was the sort of whiteness that comes over some people's faces, not when they are frightened, but when they are angry. For a moment, the witch fixed her eyes on the prince, and there was murder in them. Then she seemed to change her mind. Leave us, she said, to the two earthmen. And let none disturb till I call on pain of death. The gnomes padded away obediently, and the witch queen shut the door and locked it. How now, my lord prince, she said. Has your nightly fit not come upon you, or is it over too soon? Why stand you here unbound? Who are these aliens, and is it they who have destroyed the chair, which was your only safety? First Corinthians 4, verses 1 and 2 say, therefore, since through God's mercy we have this ministry, we do not lose heart. Rather, we have renounced secret and shameful ways, and we do not use deception, nor do we distort the word of God. On the contrary, by setting forth the truth plainly, we commend ourselves to everyone's conscience in the sight of God. Prince Rilian shivered as the queen spoke to him. And no wonder. It's not easy to throw off in half an hour the enchantment which has made one a slave for 10 years. Then speaking with a great effort, he said, Madam, there will be no more need of that chair. And you, who have told me 100 times how deeply you pitied me for the sorceries by which I was bound, will doubtless hear with joy that they are now ended forever. There was, it seems, some small error in your ladyship's way of treating them. These my true friends have delivered me, and I am now in my right mind, and there are 2 things I will say to you. First, as for your ladyship's design of putting me at the head of an army of earthmen so that I may break out into the overworld and there by main force make myself king over some nation that never did me wrong, murdering their natural lords and holding their throne as a bloody and foreign tyrant, now that I know myself, I do utterly abhor and renounce it as plain villainy. And second, I am the king's son of Narnia, Rilian, the only child of Caspian, 10th of that name, whom some call Caspian the Seafarer. Therefore, madam, it is my purpose, as it is also my duty, to depart suddenly from your highness's court into my own country. Please it to you to grant me and my friends safe conduct and a guide through your dark realm. Now the witch said nothing at all, but moved gently across the room, always keeping her face and eyes very steadily towards the prince. When she had come to a little ark set in the wall, not far from the fireplace, she opened it and took out first a handful of green powder. This she threw on the fire. It did not blaze much, but a very sweet and drowsy smell came from it. And all through the conversation which followed, that smell grew stronger and filled the room and made it harder to think. Secondly, she took out a musical instrument, rather like a mandolin. She began to play it with her fingers, a steady, monotonous thrumming that you didn't notice after a few minutes. But the less you noticed it, the more it got into your brain and your blood. That also made it hard to think. After she had thrummed for a time, and the sweet smell was now strong, she began speaking in a sweet, quiet voice. Narnia, she said. Narnia. I've often heard your lordship utter that name in your ravings. Dear prince, you are very sick. There is no land called Narnia. Yes, there is, though, ma'am, said Puddleglum. You see, I happen to have lived there all my life. Indeed, said the witch. Tell me, I pray, dear creature, where that country is. Up there, said Puddleglum, stoutly pointing overhead. I don't know exactly where. How, said the queen, with a kind of soft musical laugh, is there a country up among the stones and mortar on the roof? No, said Puddleglum, struggling a little to get his breath. It's an overworld. And what or where, pray, is this? How do you call it, overworld? Oh, don't be so silly, said Scrub, who was fighting hard against the enchantment of the sweet smell and the thrumming. As if you didn't know, it's up above where you can see the sky and the sun and the stars. I cry you mercy, little brother, laughed the witch. You couldn't have heard a lovelier laugh. I have no memory of ever being there, but we often experience strange things in our dreams, and unless all dreamed alike, you must not ask them to remember it. Madam, said the prince sternly, I've already told your grace that I am the king's son of Narnia. And shalt be, dear friend, said the witch in a soothing voice, as if she were humoring a child, shalt be the king of many imagined lands in thy fancies. We've been there too, Jill snapped. She was very angry because she could feel the enchantment getting hold of her every moment, but of course the very fact that she could still feel it showed that it had not yet fully worked. And thou art queen of Narnia too, I doubt not, pretty one, said the witch, in the same coaxing, half-mocking tone. I'm nothing of the sort, said Jill, stamping her foot. We come from another world. Oh, why, this is a prettier game than the other, said the witch. Tell us, little maid, where is the other world? What ships and chariots go between it and ours? 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 3 says, and even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. The God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers so that they cannot see the light of the gospel that displays the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. Of course, when the queen said this, a lot of things darted into Jill's head at once. Experiment house, Adela Pennyfather, her own home, radio sets, cinemas, cars, airplanes, ration books, cues. But they seemed dim and far away. Thrum, thrum, thrum went the strings of the witch's instrument. Jill couldn't remember the names of the things in our world. And this time it didn't come into her head that she was being enchanted, for now the magic was in full strength, and of course, the more enchanted you get, the more you feel that you're not enchanted at all. She found herself saying, and at the moment it was quite a relief to say, no, I suppose that the other world must be all a dream. Yes, it's all a dream, said the witch, always thrumming. Yeah. It's all a dream, said Jill. There never was such a world, said the witch. No, said Jill and Scrub, there never was such a world. There never was any world but mine, said the witch. There never was any world but yours, said they. Puddleglum was still fighting hard. I don't know what rightly you all mean by a world, he said, talking like a man who hasn't had enough air. But you can fiddle till your fingers drop off, and you still won't make me forget Narnia, and the whole overworld, too. We'll never see it again, I shouldn't wonder. You may have blotted it out and turned it all dark like this, for all I know. Nothing more likely. But I know I was there once, and I've seen the sky full of stars. I've seen the sun coming up out of the sea of morning and sinking behind the mountains at night. I've seen him up in the midday sky when I couldn't look at him for brightness. Puddleglum's words had a very rousing effect. The other three all breathed in again and looked at one another like people newly awaked. Why, there it is, cried the prince. Of course, the blessing of Aslan upon this honest marshwiggle. We have all been dreaming these last few minutes. How could we have forgotten it? Of course, we've all seen the sun. By Jove, so we have, said Scrub. Good for you, Puddleglum. You're the only one of us with any sense, I do believe. Then came the witch's voice, cooing softly like the voice of a wood pigeon from the high elms in an old garden at 3 o'clock in the middle of a sleepy summer afternoon. And it said, "What is this son that you all speak of? Do you mean anything by the word?" "Oh, yes, we jolly well do," said Scrub. "Can you tell me what it's like?" asked the witch. Thrum, 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 went the strings. "Please it, your grace," said the prince very coldly and politely. "You see that lamp? It's round and yellow and gives light to the whole room and hangeth moreover from the roof. Now that thing which we call the sun is like the lamp, only far greater and brighter. It giveth light to the entire overworld and hangeth in the sky." "Hangeth from what, my lord?" asked the witch. And then while they were all still thinking how to answer her, she added with another of her soft silver laughs, "You see, when you try to think clearly what the sun must be, you cannot tell me. You can only tell me that it is like the lamp in this room. Your sun is a dream, and there is nothing in that dream that was not copied from the lamp. The lamp is the real thing. The sun is but a tale, a children's story." "Yes, I see now," said Jill in a heavy, hopeless tone. "It must be so." And while she said this, it seemed to her very good sense. Slowly and gravely, the witch repeated, "There is no sun." And they all said nothing. She repeated in a softer and deeper voice, "There is no sun." After a pause and after a struggle in their minds, all four of them said together, "You are right. There is no sun." It was such a relief to give in and say it. "There never was a sun," said the witch. "No, there never was a sun," said the prince and the marshwiggle and the children. For the last few minutes, Jill had been feeling that there was something she must remember at all costs, and now she did, but it was dreadfully hard to say it. She felt as if huge weights were laid on her lips. At last, with an effort that seemed like it took all the good out of her, she said, "There's Aslan." "Aslan?" said the witch, quickening ever so slightly the pace of her thrumming. "What a pretty name. What does it mean?" "He's the great lion who called us out of our own world," said Scrub, "and sent us into this one to find Prince Rillian." "What is a lion?" asked the witch. "Oh, hang it all," said Scrub. "Don't you know? How can we describe it to her? Have you ever seen a cat?" "Surely," said the queen. "I love cats." "Well, a lion is a little bit, only a little bit, mind you, like a huge cat with a mane. At least, it's not like a horse's mane, you know. It's more like a judge's wig, and it's yellow and terrifically strong." The witch shook her head. "I see," she said, "that we should do no better with your lion, as you call it, than you did with your son. You have seen lamps, and so you imagined a bigger and better lamp and called it the sun. You've seen cats, and now you want a bigger and better cat, and it's to be called a lion. Well, 'tis a pretty make-believe, though to say the truth, it would suit you all better if you were younger. And look how you can put nothing into your make-believe without copying it from the real world, this world of mine, which is the only world. But even you children are too old for such play. As for you, my lord, prince, thou art man full grown. Fie upon you. Are you not ashamed of such toys? Come, all of you, put away these childish tricks. I have work for you all in the real world. There is no Narnia, no overworld, no sky, no sun, no Aslan. And now to bed all, and let us be wiser in life tomorrow. But first to bed, sleep deep. Sleep, soft pillows, sleep without foolish dreams." The prince and the two children were standing with their heads hung down, their cheeks flushed, and their eyes half closed, and the strength all gone for them. The enchantment almost complete. But Puddleglum, desperately gathering all his strength, walked over to the fire. Then he did a very brave thing. He knew it wouldn't hurt him quite as much as it would hurt a human, for his feet, which were bare, were webbed and hard and cold-blooded like a duck's. But he knew it would hurt him badly enough, and so he did. With his bare foot, he stamped on the fire, grinding a large part of it into ashes on the flat hearth. And three things happened at once. First, the sweet, heavy smell grew very much less, for though the whole fire had not been put out, a good bit of it had, and what remained smelled very largely of burnt marshwiggle, which is not at all an enchanting smell. This instantly made everyone's brain far clearer. The prince and the children held up their head and again opened their eyes. Secondly, the witch, in a loud, terrible voice, utterly different from the sweet tone she had been using until now, called out, "What are you doing? Dare to touch my fire again, mud filth, and I'll turn the blood to fire inside your veins." Thirdly, the pain itself made Puddleglum's head for a moment perfectly clear, and he knew exactly what he really thought. There is nothing like a good shock of pain for dissolving certain kinds of magic. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 5 and 6 say, "For what we preach is not ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord, and ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake. For God who said, 'Let light shine out of darkness,' made his light shine in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of God's glory displayed in the face of Christ." "One word, ma'am," he said, coming back from the fire, limping because of the pain. "One word. All you've been saying is quite right. I shouldn't wonder. I'm a chap who's always liked to know the worst and then put the best face I can on it, so I won't deny that any of what you said. But there's one thing more to be said, even so. Suppose we have only dreamed or made up all those things, trees and grass and sun and moon and stars and Aslan himself. Suppose we have then, all I can say is that in that case, the made-up things seem a good deal more important than the real ones. Suppose this black pit of a kingdom of yours is the only world. Well, it strikes me as a pretty poor one. And that's a funny thing when you come to think of it. We're just babies making up a game, if you're right. But four babies playing a game can make a play world which licks your real world hollow. That's why I'm going to stand by the play world. I'm on Aslan's side, even if there isn't any Aslan. I'm going to live as a Narnian as long as I can, even if there isn't any Narnia. So thanking you kindly for our supper, if these two gentlemen and young lady aren't ready or are ready, we're leaving your court at once and setting out into the dark to spend our lives looking for overland. Not that our lives will be very long, I should think, but that small loss, if the world is a dull place as you say." "Oh, hurrah! Good old Puddleglum," cried Scrub and Jill. But the prince shouted suddenly, "Where? Look, the witch!" When they did, their hair nearly stood on end. The instrument dropped from her hands. Her arms appeared to be fastened to her sides. Her legs were intertwined with each other, and her feet had disappeared. The long green train of her skirt thickened and grew solid and seemed to be all one piece with the writhing green pillar of her interlocked legs. And that writhing green pillar was curving and swaying as if it had no joints or else were all joints. Her head was thrown as far back, and while her nose grew longer and longer, every other part of her face seemed to disappear except her eyes. Huge, flaming eyes they were now, without brows or lashes. All this takes some time to write down, but it happened so quickly that there was only time to see it. Long before there was time to do anything, the change was complete, and the great serpent which the witch had become, green as poison, thick as Jill's waist, had flung two or three coils of its loathsome body around the prince's legs. Quick as lightning, another great loop darted around, intending to pinion his sword arm to his side, but the prince was just in time. He raised his arms and got them clear. The living knot that closed around his chest, ready to crack his ribs like firewood when it drew tight. The prince caught the creature's neck in his left hand, trying to squeeze it till it choked. This held its face, if you could call it a face, about 5 inches from his own. The forked tongue flickered horribly in and out, but could not reach him. With his right hand, he drew back his sword for the strongest blow he could give. Meanwhile, Scrub and Puddleglum had drawn their weapons and rushed to his aid. All three blows fell at once. Scrub's, which didn't even pierce the scales and did no good, on the body of the snake below the prince's hand, but the prince's own blow and Puddleglum's both on its neck. Even that did not quite kill it, though it began to loosen its hold on Rillian's legs and chest. With repeated blows, they hacked off its head. The horrible thing went on coiling and moving like a bit of wire long after it had died, and the floor, as you may imagine, was a nasty mess. The first way that we're transformed by God's glory is when our minds are set free from darkness. When the enchantment of our sinful world loses its grip on our heads and we see the world for what it is. Don't listen to the thrumming around you and grow weary. Don't fall victim to the daily rhythm of your life convincing you that there is nothing besides our world. When you get to living this life and this world like it's the only one, and the things that you do each day for your job and in your house and in your yard or with your hobbies are the only things that matter, you are truly enchanted. God, who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," made his light shine in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of God's glory displayed in the face of Christ. And by this light, we know that our world and the corruption it suffers is passing away. And by this light, we turn our minds to God, to his word, to his will, and to his spirit, and we worship him for rescuing us from our enchantment. So let's stand and do that together now this morning. Please join me in prayer. Dear God, thank you for rescuing us from darkness. Thank you for breaking the spell of just the vicious cycle of our mortal life. Dear Holy Father, just forgive us for all the times that we have spent ignoring your truth, the kingdom of heaven, the reality of our life beyond the grave, and the wonder of your Son, Jesus. Dear Heavenly Father, open our eyes and free us from the darkness of our world. Free us from the darkness of hopelessness so that we can understand who we truly are and who we will truly be in your eternal kingdom. Pray these things in your name. Amen.